present Linda Smith's A Brief History of Timewasting.
Oh, what's happening? What am I doing on the sofa? Oh, the last thing I remember is late last night. I was watching some trashy TV show, America's Dumbest Presidents. Oh, it was quite good, actually. Fancy Gerald Ford not being able to do buttons up. And George W. thinking that if pollution gets too bad, we could all live in pods on the moon. Oh, I feel terrible. My eyes sting like a laboratory rabbit. Oh, I can't see. Can you get cataracts overnight? No, I've fallen asleep with my contact lenses in. A little squirt of WD-40 should shift them. Oh, that's better. I probably missed all the good radio now. Let's see.
Misery of infertility. Tomorrow on Woman's Hour, people who miss their wisdom teeth air their sense of loss. Until then, goodbye.
Next on Radio 4, So Sue Me, our new panel game in which famous failed litigants sue each other in the style of successful litigants. Gillian Telforth is in the chair, and the team captains are Neill and Christine Hamilton.
What is this baffling urge the media have to rehabilitate the wretched Hamiltons? Though in fairness to Christine, when you see the two of them together and you catch the look in his eye, you just know that she makes sure that man lives in hell. Credit where it's due. Oh, this will cheer me up. A new addition to my Franklin Mint limited edition hand-finished porcelain Songbirds of Britain collection. Let's have a look. Ah, my nightingale. It's broken. Oh, well, the numbers are dwindling anyway, so it saved me the trouble of smashing it myself when I next update my collection. Oi! Oi, get off! Get out of it! Oh, put it down! Put my blackbird down! Oh, the Franklin Mint is a victim of its own hand-finished detail. My blackbird poisoned by slug bait figurine is so death-like, it's been mistaken for carrion and hauled off by one of those escaped vultures that now roam our land in flocks. Where's my living builder, Chris? Chris, what are you doing down there?
Oh, hello, Linda, love. I'm just clearing out your voids. Your subfloor voids are clogged with rubble.
Should they be that deep?
Well, strictly speaking, no. But you know, it's a funny thing. The more rubble I clear, the more comes up to the surface. I think we've got moles. Give us a hand, will you? Oh, still, not to worry. I can always turn it into a basement conservatory. Yeah, you can grow some of the less frost-hardy mildews and slimes there. Are you wearing a face pack?
No, it's dried dribble. Oh. Fell asleep in front of the telly.
Oh, not again. Do you know, you're a fool to yourself, Linda. The last time you did that, you had that terrible nightmare about Jeremy Clarkson.
Oh, yes. The thinking woman's fat, ugly bloke.
I'd better run you a bath.
Cheers. I'll liven myself up with a bit of daytime telly.
Okay.
Protesting against a new road parallel to the M13 link-up in East London. This road will eliminate noise from local houses, which drivers find annoying. Police and bailiffs had to use SAM rockets to remove an elderly Buddhist nun who was trying to save a tree in the path of the bulldozer. The full story of this incident can be seen in our special feature, When Nuns Attack. That's all the news in the South East. Hello. When you get to our age, you'll be dead soon. So sod saving up your cash and leaving it to your grasping grandchildren. Where were they when you were having that hip operation? Oh, they sent you a text message. Who bloody rare. Let them worry about your funeral costs and make your final expenses one of our club 6,500 cruises. 2 weeks of all the booze, balls and warden-assisted sex you can handle.
As we know, when you're old, no one gives a monkey's about you. So ensure your future in a private nursing home now by making over all your property and money to us, plus 50% of your children's earnings in perpetuity, and giving us your nieces and nephews as bonded slaves.
Try lithium. With lithium, you can laugh at incontinence and all sorts of other things that aren't really funny.
Oh, Gordon, Jackson, I forgot that this is the time of day when advertisers chase the grey pound. Oh, it's depressing. All I need now to enhance my mood is for my elderly neighbour Betty, specialist subject all things morbid, to appear.
Hello. Dead woman walking.
Betty, where did you spring from?
I came through the emergency flap that Chris made for me. I can't stand outside waiting for you to answer the door with my bones crumbling like feta cheese on a Greek salad.
I'm sorry, I'm not having a Betty flap in the house. I know where that's going to lead to. You'll be getting all your mates round when I'm out. I'll be overrun with pensioners. Drinking my tea, kipping on the furniture. In fact, I couldn't swear to it, but is there a faint whiff of Werther's Originals and lavender water in the air?
I'm saying nothing. I'm taking the fifth.
What does that mean?
I've no idea, but I've heard it on Diagnosis Murder.
It's all right, Linda. I'm working on a magnetic headscarf, so Betty's the only OOP who can access my flat.
I'm sorry, Chris. It will have to go. So, what do you want, Betty?
Two things. Firstly, I brought a bit of my sister Marjorie's fruitcake for Chris.
Oh, lovely. Do you know, that really is the driest bit of cake I've ever clapped my eyes on. Are you sure this piece is big enough to draw out all the moisture from a newly plastered wall?
Trust me, you've got enough there to dehumidify a Turkish bath. Oh, yes, and the other thing is I need to discuss the plans for my mausoleum.
What?
That's right. Well, you see, Betty, I have been flicking through the style section of some of your witch funeral magazines, and I've settled on this design. I think it combines the optimism of the London Eye with the raw pathos of the dome. The giant roulette wheel spins, and then your embalmed form, Betty, drops into one of these numbered slots. It's truly a game of Russian roulette.
Oh, it's lovely. But the thing is, you see, I'm not so sure about the embalming now. I've been reading up about it. What happens is they hollow you out with a melon scoop, fill you with old tights, give you a coat of varnish, shave your head and draw a goatee beard on you.
No, Betty, you're thinking of Lenin. They didn't do that to him. That's what he looked like when he was alive.
No, he didn't. Stalin doctored all the photos of him. In reality, Lenin had a jet black quiff and wore sunglasses all the time, like Roy Orbison.
Whatever. Can we change the subject, please?
Oh, yes. Linda, I've got a social invitation for you.
Oh, that's more like it.
I'm invited too. I'll pop home and put a coat on.
You've got a coat on?
No, an outdoor coat.
Well, I'll come straight round once I've had a bath and scraped the dribble off my face. Oh, by the way, invitation to... Oh, she's gone.
Can I come?
No, you've got to brick up that flap and replace the floor.
Mm. Don't tell me I've nothing to do.
Well, that was a nice bath. You know, it's funny, though. Unless that was a very agile loofah, I could swear there was an otter in there with me.
Probably was. These urban otters are very bold. I came into the kitchen the other day to find one legging it out the door with a lovely bit of haddock I'd bought for our tea.
That must have been the night we had Pop-Tarts Mornay.
Yes.
Urban otters, though, are you sure?
Oh, yeah, you know, encouraged by the success of foxes, otters have made their way to the city where their natural cheekiness has spilled over into sheer criminality.
Really?
Oh, yeah, Mrs. Padgett down the road had one at the door the other day with a very plausible yarn, said he'd locked himself out the house a few doors away with no cash on him and could he borrow a tenner for a cab because he had to get to the hospital where, apparently, his wife was having a baby. Mrs. Padgett was about to give it to him when she suddenly realised he said he lived at number 27, when, as you will know, Linda, the numbers in our street only go up to 25.
You've got to be so careful. Right, I'm off to Betty's via the door. I'm boycotting that flat.
Please yourself. Bye.
Come in, it's open. I've just been lending a tenner to a bloke who's locked himself out. Funny looking bugger he was, all sleek and hairy, quite clumsy, but I should imagine very graceful in water.
So what's this do we're going to?
Well, you know Mr. Wallace.
No, I don't think so.
Oh, you do know Mr. Wallace.
No, I don't.
You do know him. Mr. Wallace, Mallory Road, slight limp ginger moustache.
I still don't know him.
You do. Mr. Wallace, Mallory Road, slight limp ginger moustache, little cat called Binky.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.